time for this meeting. But if there's anyone, anyone who's absent at that meeting wishes to declare a relevant interest in connection to any matters to be determined at this meeting, please do so now.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to declare an interest by reference some of my clerks in the Education Department.
Thank you. Right. I've been notified of the following apologies. Councillors Julie McManus, Tom Anderson, Mike Collins, Tony Cox, Liz Gray, Mary Jordan, Anita Leach, Terry Corbo and Alison Wright. Are there any further apologies?
Mr. Mayor, Councillor Mike Sullivan.
Thank you.
Councillor Ryan.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, can I just ask if we are to the court?
Yes, we are, yes. We are, yes. 25% is needed. Okay. Just want to let councillors know I will be adhering strictly to the time limits during this meeting. Please do not ask for more time, as I would like to refuse you. Can I also remind members that they are free to leave the chamber and take a comfort break when they wish, although it should aim to be present for any votes. I'll sort of go along tonight. If we need a break after perhaps around half past 7 or 8 o'clock, I'll be led by members on that for a comfort break. So, I know people sometimes need to get out on that.
Mr. Mayor, if I may at this point, could I move suspension of standing order 9 and invoke the guillotine with immediate effect?
I do a second.
Mr. Mayor, I would object strongly to Council Blakely's suggestion. I did indicate to leaders yesterday that I would prefer a debate on the first four items, but I understand the members think about the time when they might take a break. I prefer to concede a guillotine at a reasonable time, but I'm certainly not prepared to have the guillotine brought in. Members have spent a degree of time preparing information over these debates, and to be fair, this is a debate about transport and air pollution, which I think this council should air, if you forgive the pun, and which a minority party to my right, the Green Party, have a particular view on, which ought to be debated thoroughly by this chamber.
If I may, in response to Councillor Gilchrist, this council had the opportunity to debate all notice of the motion at its meeting last week. It chose not to, and the Liberals chose not to. That's disagreement.
I agree with Councillor Gilchrist. I think we should, as we agreed when we agreed yesterday, thank you for this floor, because everyone has a chance to keep up with their speech tonight. I think it's only fair. There might be people making their first speech at the main speech. It's a lot of time, a lot of effort, and for anybody to get up in this fair, it's a proper place. So I'd like to go a little bit further to what the guillotine is at.
He moved the guillotine to be put in place after the government's debate. He refused. refused the opportunity to have these debates last week. I find the due term quite staggering.
Okay, that's a bit good. Can you just a minute? Okay, we'll move on that motion then. So, can you put your proposal, please? Okay, and it's been seconded by Councillor Rennie. Okay, can we have a vote on that, please? So, the guillotine immediately. And we will go to electronic voting. So when I get the signal, I'll tell you when to vote. This way, enough. Please wait.
Consider and debate upon the first four motions on the order paper and review the situation taking place.
Thank you. Have we got a second for that?
Second.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, we'll vote on that. And by hands again. Those in favour, please put their hands up.
Slag, God, Marxist witch, bitch, show some decorum, fat cow, not worth raping, lefty scum. I've been spat at, I've had a man swear up to me and poke his finger in my face. Mr. Mayor, this is not acceptable. Mr. Mayor, I know all too well the importance of language and how language has consequences. I was responsible for a puerile and offensive tweet 8 years ago before I was a councillor, and I apologised at the time. I'm embarrassed and ashamed of what I wrote there. I re-evaluated the language I used, and I think I've learnt a valuable lesson. Mr. Mayor, we witnessed the horrific murder of Joe Cox in June 2016 by a far-right extremist whose name I won't dignify tonight. He shouted, "Make Britain great," as he killed her. It shone spotlight on how the political discourse had sunk so low and how women's lives can be a danger from male violence and extremism. Mr. Mayor, the murder of Joe Cox and the issue of violence against women was brought sharply into focus that day in June 2016. I was devastated that an amazing woman's life was taken from her. That husband was denied his wife, their children and their mother, and society with talent that sought to unify the community and see the good in people. Mr. Mayor, in those dark days, I had hoped that the tone and language that accompanied Joe's murder would not only be roundly condemned by politicians, but that people will start to think about what they said and how they said it. Instead, we've seen a continuation and amplification of extremist language. We've seen trivialisation of rape and domestic abuse. Mr. Mayor, imagine my horror when Michael Gove likened appearing on Radio 4 to going into Harvey Weinstein's bedroom. You hope to emerge with your dignity intact. This as well in the face of a Me Too movement. Mr. Mayor, imagine my horror when the Attorney General, Geoffrey Cox, in a debate about proroguing the Parliament, asked them to reply effort, "When did you stop beating your wife?" Mr. Mayor, imagine my revulsion when I see Conservative MP Mark Field slam a peaceful female protester up against the wall and grab her by the throat. These are not the actions of a civilised man. Even worse was Boris Johnson's cowardly refusal to sack him, fearful that his weight for thin majority would be in jeopardy. And so, Mr. Mayor, we come to the Prime Minister himself. In a recent parliamentary debate, Paul Sheriff MP implored about how language was becoming toxic in Parliament and how she was being threatened herself. Paul Sheriff spoke about the febrile environment politicians, particularly female politicians, faced in the aftermath of Joe Cox's murder. She implored all politicians, including Boris Johnson, to moderate their language as it was fueling a toxic environment. This was dismissed as humbug. At a time when the domestic violence bill was delayed because Boris Johnson had unlawfully prorogued Parliament. Mr. Mayor, time and again we see Conservative parliamentarians trivialise violence towards women. The delay in the domestic violence bill could have had terrible ramifications for rural residents here who are suffering from domestic abuse. Rape and violence towards women is not a joke. It should be afforded the gravity it deserves. Those politicians who seek to trivialise and laugh at domestic abuse and rape serve to demean themselves and their office. While I'm pleased to note that the Domestic Violence Bill has now been put back on the agenda for Parliament, I am disgusted with the misogyny that's been laid bare over the last few weeks. Whether it be the assaulted Mark Field of a peaceful female protester, or the casual sexism of a local councillor telling me to show some decorum. Women deserve better than this. Domestic abuse survivors on Wirral and across the country deserve better than this. Democracy deserves better than this. Mr. Mayor, I ask everyone in the chamber tonight to reflect on how the language and tone of political debate needs to be improved. I ask them to roundly condemn the words and actions of parliamentarians I've spoken about tonight. I ask them to support the policy of zero tolerance towards domestic abuse taken by this council and urge the leader to write to the Prime Minister and ask his him and his colleagues to treat the survivors of domestic abuse with the dignity and respect that they deserve. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Linson. We move on to the debate. Are there any speakers? And we could just take some names first of all, and then just remain standing for a couple of minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm very proud to stand here and support this motion. What we've seen over recent months is the government behaviour in respect of women in particular and their disregard for the violence and the appalling sexist and misogynist language that we're hearing. It's been articulated in the most appalling way by our Prime Minister. We've heard language that is prepared and an attitude that is prepared to belittle anyone who doesn't fit that classic Tory mould of that privately educated white male. It shows very, very clearly the attitude of the Tory party. Doesn't care that the domestic abuse bill would have fallen off the parliamentary agenda without the intervention of the Supreme Court. It was as a direct result of their attempt to avoid the democratic process and to manipulate their own desired results, the outcome of the votes in Parliament. This was a vital bill and is a vital bill to protect the 1 in 3 women and the 1 in 6 men who will suffer from domestic abuse. Most of those will survive, traumatised, damaged, injured, but alive. But every week, 2 of them won't. We need to think about that. It's not surprising, really, that this attitude comes from the worst government that we have seen this century. They managed to turn a majority of 1 into a deficit of 41, a government of total chaos. And judged by the highest court in our country, it's a lack of truthfulness. What does that say about this government and about this party? And what it does say is that the women and men who are subject to domestic abuse in Wirral will know how little they are valued by this Tory party and by this government.
Mr. Mayor, I would also offer my assurance to to gain political favour for that. And my comment, my last comment, Mr Mayor, that is a political comment. All the points that Councillor Nolan raised, if the government is that bad, and she said, I think whatever the words were, what does that say about the government? I have to say, if the government is still 15% of the Labour Party, 15% ahead of the Labour Party, what does that say about the Labour Party?
Our language see the tears upwards, then recognise the role that we play as people who speak on an everyday basis. So we can talk about language that might just seem like locker room talks or jokes or just something that's quite informally said between friends and colleagues, and really go potentially one of three people as potential perpetrators of domestic violence in those conversations, listening to us, and slowly but surely we are dehumanising people who could become their victims. So if we help dehumanise a whole section of the population, then when it comes to street crime and things that people say to one another out and about in public, if you've heard people use the kind of language that Councillor Green talked about, when you're angry and frustrated, then that harassment is absolutely normalised. It's perfectly normal for you to pull on one of those really unpleasant words and shout it in the street. And if you shout it in the street, then absolutely why not, when you're in a home environment and you're under pressure and you're stressed and whatever different triggers could be, you're absolutely more likely to then feed into a violent situation just in the time. The point I would really like to make then is if you can understand the role that your language as an everyday citizen or the leader then plays into harassment and into violence, then I think we can definitely do more to hold ourselves to account. This happens right across the political spectrum and it will happen on an everyday basis to people. I would really like you to support the motion and I hope you'll join me in committing to try and hold yourselves and your peers and absolutely your leaders, for all of us, to better account. Thank you.
Should stop, especially Mr. Mayor, following Pat Hattie's comments.
first speech as leader when he said we should be all working in harmony without the nasty comments, to which I'm sure we all agree. So I agree to the motion with regards to the resurrection and implementation, because I've made it quite clear that I don't fully agree with all the parts of the other parts of the motion where you criticised Conservative MPs without shining the spotlights on your own MPs. There was not one criticism against any of the Labour MPs. There was not one criticism. That is hypocrisy. So please get your own house in order first. Thank you.
Thank you.
Guarantee you, no one has tried harder in my life to see the point of view
started in the 70s when the language used reflected the so-called accepted morals of the early 20th century, where misogynist or racist language and behaviour was accepted. British telly reinforced this idea with carry-on films Love Thy Neighbour, etc. Where women, the LGBT plus community, or anyone not fitting the middle class nuclear family rhetoric were ridiculed. We've come so far to let this go unchallenged. It's never been okay, and it's never been accepted. I, being a fairly new member, of this chamber, I've never spoken out, but no good conscience cannot sit back and let this motion be undermined by an effort to let this kind of rhetoric go unchallenged. This latest effort of the right wing to normalise offensive and abusive language will not go unchallenged and will be called out for what it is. Our unelected PM has used this disgusting rhetoric over and over to reinforce his archaic ideas. I am happy to tell all that I am the husband of a strong, fearless and peerless individual, a father of two strong, determined and fair-minded human beings. And as a family, we might disagree, we might argue, but we don't agree with one another, either verbally or physically. But this is not the case for 2 million people living in our country who live in fear of domestic violence. I'm 6'3", white, middle-aged, but according to the right-wing Tory press, people like me are snowflakes, because I do not accept their horrendous rhetoric. Vilification of feminism or any minority group is a well-played out tactic of right-wing extremists. This is a very slippery slope and must be checked. It's easy to make thoughtless comments, I'm sure we all have, I certainly have, as we all know. But when these comments are consistently used to undermine belittle women, religious or ethnic minorities and the LGBT plus community, including our own elected members of both sides of the chamber, we need to call it out for what it is. I do not want to repeat the awful terms being used freely and consistently by a small group of powerful, privately educated and extremely wealthy men, but we must prevent this language becoming normalised. This language has emboldened and motivated violence against women. Each year, since March 2016, on International Women's Day, Jess Phillips, the MP for Birmingham Yardley, stands up in the House of Commons and reads out a list of all the names of women killed in the UK that previous year. This is an epidemic. All of those women matter. And if we can work together to combat domestic violence in our borough, as so rightly called out, it's a great success from all sides of the chamber. We can live in hope that this list might be a little bit shorter next year. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Emergency, they would be put back together physically but not mentally,
right to occur up to, as my colleague mentioned, to Joe Wood's establishment, as I call it, the Plaza unit up on Redstone Lane, just to really show her and try to say to her that lots more need to be done. But particularly really just to remind myself from where I was when I was 19, which was a long, long time ago now, to where we are today. But quite clearly, domestic abuse, whether it be from a female onto a male or the other way around, is something which cannot be tolerated and should not be tolerated.
Why is it tolerated with my child then? My child's been abused by the local authority. So I don't know what you're saying, I thought.
Sorry.
Mr.
Mayor, if I can just continue, I will wind up now. But clearly, the gist of this notice of motion as well, I fully agree with it. I'll be happy to support it. I don't think I ever verbally abused anybody in this particular chamber or outside of it. I know that's not the case. I know that a colleague of mine was quite horrific.